Hi, everyone. My name is Patrick Burkett, and I teach History of American Popular Music here at IUPUI. Now, my class is primarily online, so if you find the information that I'm going to give today interesting, please come and take my class. Would love to have everybody in the class. And what we deal with is what we call popular music. And there's a difference, and I'm going to explain that to you. But first, I'd like to thank Ricardo for allowing me to come in and talk with everybody about popular music and the history, because a lot of people do not understand the beginning of what popular music is. And that's what I'm calling this talk, is the beginning. Because of the fact that a lot of people, what they do is they kind of mess up the word of popular music and pop music, because there is a big difference. In our society today, we always kind of shorten everything. So when we're talking about popular music, everybody will say, well, pop music. Well, there's a difference. Popular music is any style of music with a very large audience. So it could be folk, country, jazz, classical, whatever would have a very large audience. Pop music primarily would be from age 13 to 22. Stuff like Taylor Swift, Shawn Mendes, just to name a few. That's pop music. The stuff that I listened to when I was a young kid and considered a teeny bopper would have been the Beatles, the Beach Boys. That was pop music for us. So when your friends and you are talking, make sure you're using the right word. And if you're talking about popular music, say popular music, not pop music. All right? So the first thing I'd like to talk about is Native American music. And this is the type of music that a lot of people, they don't pay any attention to. And this picture right here is called the land bridge. And the land bridge is how the Native Americans got over to America, because of the fact that on the Bering Strait up top of the Alaska, the seas would rise and fall. And when they fell, it made a bridge so people could come across to Alaska at that time, or our time right now, and they became, then when the seas would rise, they would be trapped. So that's how they got in here. Now, you're also going to notice that, if you haven't already, that a lot of the Indians that we have in America have an Asian descent in them. They kind of look kind of Asian. And you're going to see some of that later on during this talk. So what I'd like to do is say something that a very wise musicologist or a music historian said once in his book, and I really like this. He said, music is an art of sounding, not writing. Because there are a lot of musicologists that say if it hasn't been documented, it didn't happen. Well, Native American music, they had a different way of documenting their works. And it wasn't the typical write on a pen and paper. They would actually take it and they'd have cave paintings. And that's how they kind of documented their music. So this quote right here is really special to me, because it's more about the music, not about the documentation. So right now, there is a territories back in the day. And here on this map, I believe there's something like 15 different territories. Now, I'm not going to go over all 15, because that would take forever and too many hours. So what I'm going to do is I'm only going to talk about two different territories. And the first one is called the Southwest Territory. And the Southwest Territory would be Indians such as the Navajo, the Hopi, the Zuni, and the Apaches. And as you can see by this image, you can see a little bit of the Asian characteristics in their faces. So this is more of the common what people think about when they think of Native Americans or Indians. Now, we have been ruined by Hollywood because of the fact that most of the time when we think of Native American music, it's, well, that's part of it, but that's not the whole picture, none whatsoever. Now, the Southwest Territory Indians, their instruments were wooden flutes. Wooden flutes play a very big role in Native American music. Same way with turtle shell, rattles, and also foot drums. They are very big. Now, the wooden flute especially is in their culture, is the way that they can get closer to the Great White Spirit because it's very spiritual and it's very haunting. And it's a beautiful, beautiful instrument. Now, this is called the Southwest Song. It doesn't have a title, but it is a wooden flute. So just give it a listen. I wish we had more time to play the whole song because it's a beautiful, beautiful piece. But this is one way. And the one thing that once you start studying some more about Native American music, you will see that every territory has a different sound in their music, like the Arctic Territory, which most people will always consider to be like this image right here, which would be the Eskimos and the Inuits. Now, the Inuits are from Canada, the upper part of Canada. And here you can really see the Asian descent on the, this is an Eskimo family. Now, the Inuits really had a very unique style, and I'm going to talk about that. The instruments that they used was hand drums and rattles, and of course, the wooden flute, and what they called the throat vocals. And this is really cool. Now, I'm sure that everybody's ever has heard of beatboxing. Well, beatboxing is nothing new because the Native Americans actually had it long before anybody in the pop music vein did it. So this is an Inuit throat singing. And listen real quick. Closely to this because of the fact that this is one man making all the sounds. And that's an Inuit throat singing. So it's really kind of different. And there again, it's a different type of sound and they use different instruments. So one of the major musicians of today are Carlos Nakai, who is a Navajo, really a phenomenal, phenomenal flautist. And he plays a lot of the wooden flutes. And he's so good at this. Now, one of his songs is called The Four Sacred Mountains. And this was recorded in the canyon of Arizona. Now, he did this on one take. And he used the reverb of the canyon And this is all natural. There's no studio tricks or anything like that. This is pure nature. And if you, I'm going to play just enough so you can hear him actually play harmony along with the echoes that he's getting off the canyon. And this is the Four Sacred Mountain. You could hear the harmonies that he's playing with himself coming off of the echo. And that's Carlos Nakai, phenomenal, phenomenal musician. Native American music is still very popular today. There is a Canyon Records, and I know most of you probably won't remember, but back in the 70s, there was a band called Redbone. And they were the first all Native American musicians that did rock and roll. And one of the guys in the band actually started a Native American label called Canyon Records. Now, it's not just typical Native American music. It also has rock and rap and jazz and classical music. It's very cool. So if you have some time, go and check out Canyon Records. All right, so now we're going to move on to the colonial music. Now, most people will not really pay any attention to it because they think, well, you know, it's kind of boring and everything like that. But there's really two types of colonial music. There is the sacred music that they would use in their worship. And then they had secular music, too, that would made for fun, for dancing, and for just for having a good time. And also, one thing that colonial music brought when they came over to the new country was folk music. And folk music is very, very important because of the fact that also folk music is a part of country music because it tells a story. And that's the cool thing about folk music, is it was one of the first storytelling style of music. And this is a one song called Barbara Allen. I'm sure Ricardo has played it for you, but I'm just going to play a little bit. This is by Mr. Pete Seeger, who was a folk musician. This is Barbara Allen.
Barbara Allen. In Scarlet Town, where I was born, there was a fair maid dwelling, made many a youth cry well-a-day, and her name was Barbary Allen.
And you could tell that Pete, especially, he was a traditionalist when it came to folk music. He was so good at it. But it tells a story, and that's very important. And when we're talking about stories, we're talking about the blues. Now, when I say the word the blues, what comes to mind to you? Most people think that, you know, when they hear the blues, they're thinking, oh, very melancholy, sadness, very dark, kind of depression type of music. And, you know, it really kind of is. And the blues really came around like 1741. That's when the blues actually was called the blues, was in 1741. Now, believe it or not, there's also happy blues. And B.B. King was really good about that one. I don't have a B.B. King song. Wish I did, but I don't. And his stuff was kind of funny and very made you smile. And I also teach the history of the blues as well, which I love the class because of the fact that if we didn't have the blues, we would not have the music that we have today. No matter what it is, hip-hop, rap, metal, pop music, popular music, whatever it may be, we wouldn't have country, we wouldn't have jazz, we wouldn't have rock and roll, we wouldn't have any of this style of music if it wasn't for the blues. And the one thing, the blues stigma was back in the day, was they called it the devil's music. And there was a guy that started, and he was a minister. He was a Baptist minister, and he started writing the blues in more of a sacred style. And that came out to be the Holy Blues. It's a very cool story. And like I say, if you want to take History of the Blues, I also teach this as well. Now, the blues, everybody says, well, where did the blues originate from? Well, one of the stories is it originated from this group of guys. It's called the griots. Now, the griots are from the southwest part of Africa. And they were a group of guys that would go around to different villages. And this was around the 14th century. They were historians and storytellers. They were praise singers. They were poets. And they were musicians. And they also chanted. Now, I had a student in one of my blues class, and I'm not going to go too much into it. Ricardo's heard it too many times. But he didn't like the blues. He thought he was in the wrong class. But then I started telling him about, he said, I just don't care for this. And I said, all right, well, give me like 10 minutes of your undivided attention. And if you still don't like it, then you can leave. He said, okay. So he came up front, sat because he was all the way in the back. And I started telling him about the griots. And the griots were sort of like, they didn't have phones and newspapers, magazines, or anything like that. So they were the storytellers of what other tribes were doing at that time. And like I said, they were musicians, they were poets, and they chanted. And I looked at this gentleman and I said, what's chanting? And he goes, rap, because that's the style of music that he was really into. Well, this is a traditional griot song. Now, you're not going to understand the words because it's more of a tribal song, but it will give you an idea of what it sounded like. Yeah, that's a traditional griot song. Now, as I was talking to the student, I asked him, I said, do you think that there are griots today? And he said, no, I would say no. It's in 14th century and now we're in, 21st century. And I said, well, that would be, you're incorrect. This is a song called Inner City Blues. Now, it's not the Marvin Gaye version, so if you know that one, but this is a griot in Southwest Africa, and he's using a language of tribal and mixed in with French. And he's talking about what most musicians talk about nowadays, injustice, poverty, drug addiction. It's It's the same story that has been told many, many, many times. This is called Inner City Blues.
Yeah.
Triste Kulissen, die meisten Leute hier geht's richtig verschissen. Verhangene schwarze Himmel, graue vertrackte Wand, alte vertackte Band. Ein Wohnblock am anderen mit stinkenden starren Häusern. Der meisten hier bedeutet das Leben nichts mehr. Das ist Heim vom Abschaum und Ausländer. Da mindert's nach noch ankommen, wenn der Puffwahn hat. Da schlafst nicht gut, wenn's nicht gewohnt bist. Wegen Sirenen, Lärm aus Kneipen und den Hunden von den Junkies. Kinder mit Asthma, Frauen mit Brustkrebs und einsame Menschen saufen den Frust weg, schnupfen den Frust weg, stupfen den Frust weg. Drei komme Dinger dafür, uns geht kein Eis weg.
That is Inner City Blues. I looked at the gentleman sitting in front of me and I said, that's my 10 minutes. What do you think? And he said, I'll stay in the class, which I'm glad he did. He was my best student. And today he's actually teaching first and second graders. He's a teacher, which is so cool to me. And he uses music to teach them. So that was, I think, the best gift that anybody's ever given me. But it's about the blues. It really is. Now, this is called Stormy Monday, and it was written by T-Bone Walker. It was a very well-known blues player and guitarist. Now, most of the rock and roll people really have abused the blues, the older blues guys. The worst, the ultimate worst, is one of my favorite bands, Led Zeppelin. They have stolen, borrowed, I should say, from most of the older blues guys. And there have been a group of musicians, James Taylor, Bonnie Raitt, Jackson Brown, have all, and I think Keb Mo has been also involved in that, they've been trying to get the royalties from a lot of the rockers and people that have used the blues guys' songs but never paid them for it. Well, this song, like I say, it was T-Bone Walker's Stormy Monday, and this is done by the Allman Brothers. Now, the Allman Brothers paid the royalties, so I have a lot of respect for them.
Stormy Monday, but Tuesday's just a bed.
Yeah, Stormy Monday by the Allman Brothers. Now, one thing that the characteristic of the blues is it's called a 12-bar blues. And I'm sure Ricardo will go more into that when he's telling you more about the blues. But every measure, 1, 2, 3, 4, is a bar. So there's 12 of those. That makes the blues. And it really makes the blues stand out from other styles of music. Well, now we're going to get into the popular music vein. And I know you've probably talked about call and response. And the call and response is something where you would have a leader actually started singing a certain phrase, and then the congregation or choir would answer. And one of the best ways to really show you this is an old song by Edward Hawkins, and it's called Oh Happy Day.
When Jesus wore, oh, when he wore, when Jesus wore, washed our sins away.
Oh, happy day,
oh, happy day,
oh, happy day,
oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
And that is Edward Hawkins' Oh Happy Day. And that's the call and response, which you hear in different styles of music throughout the centuries. Now, there are also a thing called the field hollers. Now, a field holler is one person, normally a guy, and he'd be in the field working. And normally they have a really high voice. And to keep their spirits up and so they don't get bored, they start singing at the top of their lungs. And back in the day, before we had all the cities and airplanes and cars and everything like that, it was pretty quiet. You could hear somebody do a field holler 1 mile, 2 miles away. Now, this is a cornfield holler. And I'm just going to play a little bit of this, and it'll give you kind of an idea what a field holler is. And that is a field holler. And that really comes into play also in some of the later music that you're going to hear. Well, there are also work songs. And one of the places that really came up was in prison. This is a work song that was done in a prison in Texas. And what they're doing is they had one person who was the leader. And what he did, this particular song, they're chopping wood. And you will hear them, they're all coming down with their axes on the wood at the same time. And that is because the leader is keeping them all in rhythm. And that is a work song. Now, back in the 60s, we had protest singers. We really did. But back in the very early part of 1800s, we had one of the first protest families. And they were called the Hutchinson family. And what they did is they protested slavery, drinking. They also were trying to give women rights to vote and have women have more rights overall. And they were a family. Now, there was 13 children. I felt so sorry for Mrs. Hutchinson because that's a lot of kids to bear. But they were very famous. And during this time, the Queen of England got a hold and heard about their music. And she invited them over to England to do a European tour for 2 years. And they were also big advocates for Lincoln. One of their songs they wrote was called Lincoln and Liberty.
choice of the nation. Our chieftain so brave and so true. We'll go for the great reformation, for Lincoln and liberty too. We'll go for the son of Kentucky, the hero of Hoosierdom through. For pride of the suckers so lucky, for Lincoln and liberty too.
So that's Lincoln and Liberty 2 by the Hutchinson Family, which when somebody says, oh, the protest music started in the 60s, you can go, ah, no, they didn't. It started back in the 1850s, and that was very important. And then also we come across the Civil War. Now, the Civil War, which started in 1861, and the cool thing, if there is a cool thing about any war, is there were more musicians in the Civil War than any other war previous and past. 28,000 musicians were involved in the Civil War. 618 bands were, no matter what, if you were in a small brigade or a platoon or anything like that, you had your own band. And that was because it kept your spirit up, especially when you're getting ready to go into battle. Now, there was one gentleman named George F. Root, and he wrote a grand total of like over 60 songs for the North. And President Lincoln gave him a citation, and in that citation, he mentioned that George did more for the Civil War than almost all of his generals because of the songs that he wrote. And one of his big ones was called Battle Cry of Freedom. Now, the one thing you're going to hear also in this, you're going to hear a guy playing a traditional four-string banjo. Now, most people don't realize that the banjo is actually an African-American instrument. So this is an original four-string banjo, and this is called Battle Cry of Freedom.
Yes, we'll rally round the flag, boys, we'll rally once again, shouting the battle cry of freedom. We will rally from the hillside, we will gather from the plain, shouting the battle cry of freedom. The Union forever, hurrah, boys, hurrah. Down with the traitor, up with the star. While we rally around the flag, boys, rally once again, shouting the battle cry of freedom.
And that is George Root, Battle Cry of Freedom. Now, I put this little guy in here. This is John Shiloh Clem. Now, excuse me. He was a drummer boy, and he was the youngest person to be in the Civil War. He joined when he was 10 years old. And he was in the majority of all the battles of the Civil War. He was in Shiloh. He was in Gettysburg. He was in a lot of the major wars. After the war ended, he wanted to stay in the Army. He really liked it. And they said, no. You've got to go get your education. And when you're old enough, after you get done with education, if you want to still feel the same, you can come back and be part of it, which he did. For a 10-year-old boy, he was pretty kind of set in his ways. He retired from the Army as a brigadier general in 1915. He was one of the last surviving Civil War survivors during the time. He died in 1932. So I just like the story of John Shiloh. Now, then we move on to the minstrels. Now, the minstrels, today we would think was terrible, very horrific, because it made fun of black people. The white entertainers would paint their faces black and go out and, you know, act and play like they were black. Well, the story that I heard and I read was there was a lot of the plantation owners would throw parties and would be dancing, and they couldn't dance very well. The slaves would be peeking around the corner and watching them and making fun of them and dancing like they were dancing. So then the plantation owner looked at them and said, oh, look at my funny slaves, how they're dancing. And that was the beginning of the minstrel shows. So the minstrel shows were actually making fun of the plantation owners. This just very, it's a very strange thing. But the minstrel shows were the only way that a lot of the songwriters and musicians could make a living. One of the best known was Stephen Foster. Now, Stephen Foster was from Cleveland, Ohio. He wasn't a very educated man, but he wrote some really good songs. Camp Town Races was one of his. My Own Kentucky Home, I think, was another one of his. And the thing is, this was his biggest song, Oh Susanna. Now, I'm going to play it, and James Taylor's going to sing it, which he's one of my favorites. The thing about Oh Susanna was Stephen Foster was not really good with money, and he had a little bit of problem with drinking. So there was a publisher that said, hey, I'll give you $100 for the right of Oh Susanna. Stephen Foster said, oh, okay, you know, $100. Back in the day, back in the, you know, 1800s, that's pretty good money. So he sold it to him. Well, the publisher made $5 million off that song. That's how popular it was. And Stephen Foster, unfortunately, died when he was 38 years old with only about 35 cents in his pocket. And he died in the gutter. Very sad. One of the best American songwriters we had. But this is Oh Susanna, sung by Mr. James Taylor.
Well, I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee. And I'm bound for Louisiana, my own true love for the sea. It did rain all night the day I left. The weather was bone dry. Now the sun was so hot I froze myself. Susan, don't you go on and cry. I said, oh, Susanna, child, don't you cry for me. As I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee.
Yeah, Oh Susanna by Stephen Foster and James Taylor. Well, now we move on to World War I. And the one thing that has always kind of surprised me was that during wartime, there were a lot of music that was written. Of course, George Root was one of them. And the other one was just gentleman right here, George M. Cohan. George M. Cohan, back in the early part of the 1900s, was a vaudeville entertainer with his family. And he wrote so many songs for the Broadway that was just unbelievable. Now, when World War I started, the President Wilson called him to the White House and said, I need you to write songs for the war because we're going to get involved, and which we did. And George said, okay, so he did. This is probably one of the best known songs that George M. Cohan wrote. It was called Over There. Now, I was fortunate from the Library of Congress to get the original recording of George M. Cohan singing this song himself on record, which I was very lucky. So this is Over There.
your gun, get your gun. Take it on the run, on the run, on the run. Hear them calling you and me, every son of liberty. Hurry right away, no delay, go today. Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. Tell your sweetheart not to mind, to be proud her boy's in line. Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums rum coming everywhere.
That was George M. Cohan, Over There. Now, that was the beginning of a very long stretch of a building in New York called the Tin Pan Alley. Now, what it was a building on, I think, the corner of 28th and 5th Avenue, if I'm not mistaken. And what they did is they had this building, and they put songwriters and lyricists together to write music. And it was really close to Broadway. So if somebody in a Broadway play wanted a song that evening, they would go to Tin Pan Alley and say, hey, I need a song for this. Here's the subject of the play. And they would write it, and they would do it that night. Now, how they got the name Tin Pan Alley is there was a reporter from the New York Herald. And during the summer, of course, in the very early part of the 1900s, there was no such thing as air conditioning. So they had to throw open the windows, and they had all these pianos and people singing, and it was just a big bunch of noise. So the writer said it sounded like a bunch of tin pans in the alley. That's how Tin Pan Alley, got its name. Some of the best known writers during Tin Pan Alley was Irving Berlin. George M. Cohan was another one. Aaron Copland, phenomenal composer. And George Gershwin. There were so many other. Then when in the late to early 60s, we had Carole King. We had Paul Simon. We had Neil Diamond. Neil Sedaka was another one. Just so many great songwriters started in the Tin Pan Alley. Well, then we're moving on to the big band swing. So this is more of a legend than anything. August 21st, 1935 to 1946. That's more or less the official time span of the big band swing. And some of these band leaders were phenomenal. Benny Goodman, for an example. He was the first band leader to have integrated band. And they would go to some cities that wouldn't let a lot of the black players stay in the hotel. And Benny Goodman said, if they're not good enough to stay in your hotel, then either am I. And he says, we won't play here. So I give him a lot of props for doing that. He was the very first to do this. And then we had Glenn Miller. Of course, everybody knows about Glenn Miller, who lost his life during the war. They still don't know exactly what happened to him. And then we had Duke Ellington, a phenomenal musician and piano player. And of course, Count Basie as well. These gentlemen, you really want to hear great music, go back and listen to some of these guys because they're so, so good. And then we move on to something called jump blues. Now, jump blues, after the war, World War II was over, and during the big band swing time, the bands would go on bus tours. Now, it didn't just happen in the 50s and 60s, but it happened in the 40s and the 30s as well, where they would pile all these bands in. There would be a 20-piece band, and they would travel from town to town and play. Well, after the war, it wasn't financially really a good idea to go around and travel and have that many pieces going along. It was expensive. So what came out of it was jump blues. It broke it down to where they, instead of having 20 people, it would have 8 to 10 people in the band. Now, one guy that I really like, and Ricardo can attest to this, is Louis Jordan, pictured right here. And to me, Louis Jordan should be the king of rock and roll. And the reason I say that is he was doing rock and roll before Elvis was even thinking about doing it. Now, I like Elvis's voice. Don't get me wrong. I hope I don't offend anybody. But Louis Jordan was doing rock and roll style of music before anybody else. He played with Ella Fitzgerald. He played with some of the best singers, Billie Holiday, that were around during this time. Now, one of his songs, which was his biggest selling song, was called Caledonia. Now, you listen to how this song sounds. Now, this was done in 1946, and this is the beginning of rock and roll.
Well, I guess I better get on in here with it. And they had nothing to eat, but she's my baby, and I love her just the same. Crazy about that woman, cause Caledonia is her name. Caledonia! Caledonia! What make your big head so hard? Ma, I love you. Love you just the same.
Now, isn't that rock and roll? I love Caledonia, as you could tell. And Louis, there again, didn't get the just recognition that I think he deserved. And what's funny is there were three artists that said that if it wouldn't have been for Louis Jordan, they wouldn't have been the artists they were. One was Little Richard. He got the little squeal that Louis was doing. And James Brown, another one. And the one that really interest me was Prince. Prince said if it wasn't for Louis Jordan, he wouldn't have been a musician. So that's pretty good praise. So then we go into rhythm and blues. Now, rhythm and blues back in the day was called race records. Country music was called hillbilly music. So back about late 49, early 50s, Billboard Records changed their charts. And the very first chart they had was called Rhythm and Blues. And the first lady to hit number one was this lady, Big Mama Thornton. She is one of my all-time favorite singers. And she did a song, and it's going to flip you out, because this was 1952 when she did this. And it's Hound Dog. Listen to her version. And then see if you can go back and listen to Elvis Presley version. I love this version. And she's also playing with Buddy Guy.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
That's Big Mama Thornton. Now, her way of doing the song was, it was more of an anthem for women, realizing that men sometimes can be a hound dog. And that's what this song was all about. When Elvis did it, he kind of cleaned it up a little bit. And I thought he kind of lost something in the transition a little bit. So then we move on to rock and roll. And one of the best well-known rock and rollers in the day was Chuck Berry. Yes, such a great guitar player. And some of the music he wrote was phenomenal, like Johnny B. Good. And that's Mr. Chuck Berry and Johnny B. Good. Yes. And that's the 50s. The 50s were basically the foreground of what rock and roll was. Then when we get into the 60s, it no longer is called rock and roll. It's called rock. And one of the best groups to really show it off was the Beatles and their song, I Want to Hold Your Hand. And everybody's heard that song, and I don't want to go too much more into it. And you know, that's actually going to end. I'm going to stop right there in the 60s. Now, a lot of people, I lived through the 60s. I'm telling my age here a bit. But they say, you know, the 60s was exciting. And I said, yeah, it was. But it was also very scary because we went through assassinations. We went through a war. We went through a Cold War with Russia. And we were always in fear of having a war with Russia. And it was just, that's why our music meant so much to us. Today, the music, sometimes I'm a little disappointed in the musicians. I think there's a lot of great musicians out there. And there are a few that write really good. Like, I'm a big fan of, like, oh, I can't think right off hand. That's terrible to say. But there are a lot of, I'm not a big fan of Taylor Swift, but I give her a lot of credit. She's a really good songwriter. She really is. And there are so many good songwriters out there, but I was hoping they have a little more in depth in their music. Well, you know, that's going to be it for History of American Popular Music. Again, I thank you for taking the time to listen, and I thank Ricardo for allowing me to come and talk with you. If you're interested in History of American Popular Music or the blues, please come and take my class. Would love to have you. In the fall, I also teach Introduction to the Music Business because I've been in it for a very long, very long time. So this is Patrick. We'll see you again, I hope. Have a great rest of your semester. We'll see you. Bye-bye now.